All of us at the 12th Precinct will be here next week at this time when Barney Miller returns. Right now, stay tuned for Evel Knievel, Portrait of a Daredevil. He takes more chances than the law allows.
In London, a mile underneath the ground in an Anaconda Company copper mine in Butte, Montana. I quit high school when I was 16 years old and went to work in these mines, contracting sometimes, keeping the water flowing from level to level. I went to work with a lot of good friends, and I lost some good friends in these mines. I think I probably quit by choice, not by chance, but I've always been proud to have been a copper miner, just as proud as the men are that still work in these mines. A lot of people ask me if I mind signing autographs, and I always tell them that I used to work a mile under the ground and never had a chance to see the sunlight, and maybe a little kid or his dad asking me for an autograph kind of helps me smile inside. Anyway, besides being a daredevil, I think I'll always be a copper miner at heart.
But Evel Knievel is not a copper miner, nor does one suspect he ever could be. Evel Knievel is a professional daredevil. His paycheck is not measured in tonnage, but in the success or failure of spectacular leaps which have turned on millions. But what is an Evel Knievel? Where did he begin? How does he do it? And where might it end? Evel Knievel. Robert Craig Knievel has come down this road many times before, just outside his hometown of Butte, Montana. Evel Knievel was born in Butte, Montana, and an incredible and bizarre career was launched. The rewards have been great. The price that Evel has paid many times has been even greater. Those were just a few of the crashes that Evel has survived over the years. There have been others, and you will see them over the course of the next hour as we take a close-up look at the past, the present, and the future of a very unusual man. In Evel Knievel, A Portrait of a Daredevil.
If you think Kellen's potato salad was great. Wait till you taste her cake.
There's no frosting.
Well, hold it. Doesn't Helen want to frost it?
Yeah, but it's great like this.
Without frosting?
Sure. Taste it.
Duncan Hines Deluxe 2. Our remarkably moist batter makes our cake so moist, even unfrosted, the taste comes alive.
It really is moist this way. Right, Helen?
Duncan Hines Deluxe 2. So moist, so delicious, they might not wait till it's frosted.
Dig, Mom, that's not him.
What?
Using Dad's antiperspirant. Use Secret. It's for women.
Secret. I used that years ago.
Oh, it's changed since you used it, Mom. It's stronger.
Stronger?
Yeah, it helps stop wetness better. And smell.
Smells pretty. You dig?
If you haven't tried Secret lately, you haven't tried Secret.
You know, Secret really works.
Mm-hmm.
And don't forget the dishes. You dig?
Welcome to the bright new world of ABC. Stuck in the clink, but making the best of it.
Beamer, you're assigned to the prison laundry. Can't hurt yourself eating soap.
One time my mother washed my mouth out with soap because I said a dirty word. At her wedding.
You meet all kinds. On the rocks. Evel Knievel is a professional life risker. It's not a new profession, but Evel has elevated the art form in today's world of mass and rapid communication almost beyond the imagination. The underlying motives of the Daredevil are a veritable smorgasbord of behavioral analysis for the psychiatric profession. And Robert Craig Knievel is the choicest morsel of the spread. His seemingly masochistic endeavors have shattered his body, garnered worldwide fame, and filled a suspected emptiness as a youth with treasure. His first and only home is an 8-acre securely guarded compound in his beloved Butte, Montana. Like Evel, is one of a kind.
Well, we always wanted to have a home of our own. I never dreamt I'd have it on three holes of the golf course. And we designed the house ourselves. Had an architect lay the plans to it. I don't know what I've got in this house and this property, probably $600,000. But it's worth every dime of it. You only live once, what the hell, you might as well go first class.
An armed guard mans the front gate of the Knievel spread, and through these gates, Evel tools some of the finest pieces of automotive machinery ever designed. The Ferrari and the customized studs with gold appointments and a mink-lined trunk fit the atmosphere of the Knievel home, a home that houses his wife Linda, sons Kelly and Robbie, and daughter Tracy. Evel is a collector of diamonds. With him, they're a passion. They adorn his cane, his jewelry, and his trophies.
Spent $200,000 or $300,000 on diamonds. And I think that if I've earned the money, and why have it sit around? Why not buy something that you can enjoy and use it? In my case, I don't have the life insurance, so it gives me a chance to spend it on something that's actually a tangible product, and I enjoy it.
Horses and the dogs,
same thing. I have the best hunting dogs in the world. I have the finest horses in the world. I have all kinds of horses. Appaloosas, saddlebreds, quarter horses, thoroughbreds, Tennessee Whoppers, Arabians. I have every kind of a horse there is.
Leva, considering all this happened, I mean the injuries and all, don't you think you could have acquired all this doing something a little more sane?
I just didn't get a kick out of getting recognition with my name on the board saying that I was a safe truck driver, or that I'd settled more papers than Johnny Jones, or that I was the best welder. I didn't like that. That didn't satisfy me. I wanted to do other things.
Well, you've done other things, all right. You travel like a Shaw now in your own customized vans. You're a hero to the kids. The main man wherever you go. It's a little out of control, though, isn't it?
I never dreamt that it would ever become as big as it's become. Ever. I don't like to save money. I think a guy should save a little. People that save money give me a pain in the neck. The only thing that makes it good that there are some people that save is that they put their money in the bank and it ups the loan limit so a guy like me can go in and borrow it and spend it. I feel that since I've risked my life to have the things that I have, that I should enjoy them. I've got a banker that tells me put your money in the bank. He's been after me to put all my money in the bank for so long that I'm getting sick and tired of hearing it. If I were to get killed, or I'd have been killed in London, for instance, this banker that wanted me to save my money, he'd go into the vault and get my money. He'd drive my Stutz or my Ferrari. He'd ride my horses. He'd move into my house. He'd sleep with my wife. He'd run my kids and my dogs over the hill. And I'm the guy that risked my life for the money. I just feel that a man has to be an idiot to make money and save it and not spend it. That's stupid. If God wanted you to hang on to money, he'd put handles on it like a suitcase so you could pack it around. It was made to spend. Spend it. That's what makes the world go round.
Evil, it would have been tough to look into these eyes and predict they belonged to one who someday would become the king of the Daredevils. Also, like a lot of kids, you're the product of a split home, the lower part of the economic scale. But according to your grandmother who raised you, you were just about the perfect kid.
He was really a very, very good boy and clean. And many times when I'd come downstairs in the morning, he'd be up and have his teeth brushed. I never told him to brush his teeth in my life. I don't think that even when Bobby got in high school that he was... He really was much different. He didn't work very well in high school. When he started the school, the teacher told me, he says, he'll never have any trouble getting along in life. He went through school all right, but he was full of mischief and everything.
He was always a daredevil driver, a good driver. Never, ever hurt anybody with a car that I knew of.
Were there ever any major problems? Did you ever arrest him?
Yes, I did. One time I and my partner, Joe Zabinica, chased him all over town out in the flat, and he turned his lights out on us. And the only reason we caught him, when he made a curve, he had put the tail lights on. Finally, we stopped him on Oregon Avenue and brought him up to jail.
Were you really that wild?
No, I wasn't a bad kid. I was just looking for something to do.
I didn't say bad, I said wild.
Well, wild. I just was looking for something to do. I did do some things that I wouldn't want my own kids to do.
Such as?
Oh, a lot of things. I spent a lot of time in jail for delinquent things like stealing hubcaps and
there's a great story that you
shoplifting.
Four hubcaps at one stoplight.
Not at a stoplight. I used to do it at the train, you know, where the train crossed, where the ore trains went from Butte to Anaconda. They made so much noise when they were going down the tracks that I just used to get the hubcaps off of somebody's car while they were sitting there waiting for the train to go by, and there was so much noise they couldn't hear me taking them off. Once in a while I'd say hi to them.
He'd build ramps out here. We didn't have all that in the buildings across the street that we have now. And he'd build ramps, and he'd would jump those bicycles across there and had all the kids in the neighborhood trying it with tricycles and everything. And he'd break up the bicycle, and we'd bring him home and punish him and take away his bicycle, and then we'd get him another bicycle.
I think one Christmas, his grandmother gave him some skis as a Christmas gift, and he tried skiing for a couple of weeks, and that wasn't exciting enough for Evel, so he traded the slalom skis for a set of jumping skis, and that March he was the Rocky Mountain regional ski jumping champion.
Of course, he met Linda in high school, which I'm happy that he ever did meet her, because there's never another girl in the world like her.
There's sort of a lot of stories about how you met Linda and how you married Linda. As always, it's hard to separate the myth from the...
Well, I had gone with her for a year, a year and a half, 2 years. And then her mother and dad decided that maybe she shouldn't be seeing so much of me. They wanted her to go to college. And all she was going to go to college for is what most girls go to college for, to get an MRS degree,
that point,
become a missus.
At that point, you didn't appear to be the prize catch of the Sunday.
That's right. At that point, I didn't appear, that's right, to be the prize catch. So, and she was going with another kid she used to go with, so I didn't like that. Anyway, I jerked her off the street a couple of times, and she didn't want to go sometimes, and I had to tie her in my car once. And I didn't tie her in the car, I got her in, but I had the other door tied shut so she couldn't get out. And I grabbed her one time going to school. Her dad was very upset with me, needless to say. And he was a hell of a guy. And I finally married her, and he didn't talk to me, I think, for probably 3 years.
Linda, there were many ways to go other than the Daredevil route. You were a good all-around athlete. You rode rodeo. You were a good hockey player, good enough for a shot at the pros. Of course, the Army kind of abbreviated that potential career, and speaking of the Army, the way you like to conform, you must have set the military back 100 years. But what I'm trying to say, Evel, is that had you chosen a different way to go, you might not have had all those problems. Armed robbery, broken bones.
Well, it could have maybe sent me in an entirely different direction, but I did the armed robbery thing, and it was on some gambling devices that were in this state that weren't supposed to be in this state, and I went in and robbed the places that had them, and then when the county attorney came after me with a warrant, I just told him that I hadn't done anything but tried to get the evidence on him for allowing gambling in the state of Montana, so he tore the warrant up and left.
Where did it turn around, though, Evel? And it had to have turned around because there were wild times, and those wild times could have, as you have said many times, have taken you to the penitentiary. Where did it cease and the Evel Knievel?
Just one day when I decided, Frank, that if I kept doing what I was doing, that I was going to end up in the penitentiary because I was going against all of society, all of the laws of society that are set up for the good of us all. And I looked in the mirror one day and decided I would lose my wife and my children unless I changed my way of life. So I decided to do something legitimate. But I didn't want to do or be a gray suit wearing, red tie wearing, white sock wearing local yokel. I don't like that way of life. I like to live like I like to live. And I decided whatever it took to make big money, I knew what price I would have to pay for that success because I didn't have much of an education.
Evel Knievel paid that price. He made his payments before handfuls of the curious, doing every possible daredevil stunt. There were years of this and months of recovering from the injuries resulting from the capricious nature of his business. They say for every big star, there's a big break. Evel made his own. It was in Las Vegas, Nevada. They laughed when this wild man said he'd jump over the big fountain at Caesar's Palace. That laughter turned to horror when the man did indeed make the jump and wound up a twisting, rolling, shattered rag doll of a human being. Yes, Evel paid the price. And in a moment, his personal physician talks about the cost.
When a man uses an aftershave, what does he really want?
Fancy bottles!
Full of fancy perfume!
And fancy prices?
No! A man wants to smell like a man!
There's something about Aqua Velva.
He wants to be cool and refreshed.
There's something about Aqua Velva.
A man wants to feel like a man.
Feel like a man, cause there's something about an Aqua Velva man.
Oh, act like they're starving.
Hey, serve us with a smile.
With this headache?
Here, try something strong. Anacin's Adult Strength.
The others are for adults.
But while ordinary aspirin, buffered aspirin, and Anacin start with the same amount of pain reliever, Adult Strength Anacin adds 23% more. Then Anacin adds an extra ingredient not found in the others.
All better?
That Anacin's great. Sure fixed my headache.
May look like just some abstract plumbing, but this is the right hip and right femur of Evel Knievel, an aftermath of the accident at Caesar's Palace. And Dr. Canty, you have, of course, went to high school with Evel Knievel. You've treated him usually after he received injuries in some other place. But would you say this perhaps was the most serious of all the injuries?
Yes, I definitely would say that this was his most serious injury.
And this, of course, doctor, is just the extension of the right leg here with the hardware and the femur. Obviously, metalwork that has gone into play.
This represents an internal fixative device in a fractured bone. In this accident, Evel sustained a fracture, a central fracture dislocation of the hip joint itself, as well as an intertrochanteric fracture of the hip. And this is the fixative device that was used to maintain those bones in alignment.
Those are very difficult words for the layman. In other words, he was in a lot of trouble here. You did mention that this, the fact that he does have a good hip now is rather remarkable.
Yes, this type of devastating injury in a young person is a crippling injury, you might say.
Over the years, now, you've treated him, as I said, for usually in the aftermath of injuries that have taken place somewhere else. How many fractures would you say that, and I guess it would have to be an approximate, but how many fractures would you say that Evel's had?
Well, you hear people refer that he's broken every bone in his body. This, of course, is an overstatement, but I would say roughly 50 bones throughout the course of his career have been fractured.
And just sorting through some of the x-rays here, we just incidentally have one up here. This is the ankle, I believe, isn't it, Doctor?
This represents an ankle fracture which he sustained in San Francisco, and this was fixed with a screw fixative device, and he was back here in town several days after this injury. He wanted this cast removed so he could jump within a few more days at Cobo Arena in Detroit.
But Doctor, as an orthopedist who has known Evel Knievel, we talked of some 50 fractures that he's had. Does the man amaze you in any way?
Well, he does in some very definite respects, yes. I think he is a true professional, that he is trying to do the best job at his profession that he can possibly do. And to have this devastating trauma every performance or every second or third performance, to me, this is amazing, yes.
As we look into the future of Evel Knievel, as a result of all these injuries, isn't there a possibility of other developments from calcium developing and become even more crippling than they are?
Well, I think age catches up with all of us, and a lot of these things are going to affect him in his later life if he's lucky enough to get into a situation where he can be moving, walking about, say during his 40s or his 50s, these injuries are going to have a definite effect on him, yes.
You say lucky. Do you kind of question that he might get to that age where he's walking around?
Well, when I analyze the mechanics of his last injury, which took place in Britain, I'm amazed that he's alive.
Mm-hmm. I was there, of course, in London when he crashed there. That was a jump of the 13 buses. And one thing that impressed me more than anything else, and I've heard the term threshold of pain for many, many years, and I know shock accompanies an injury and all that, but is Evel's threshold of pain remarkably higher than the ordinary person?
I would say yes. He has his injuries with dignity.
You paid a price, Evel. You wore one of these things in your leg as a result of one accident. You had
five of those.
Five of these?
Yeah, five of those put in. I broke
this,
five.
Of course, we saw in the x-ray, this goes into the hip, this goes onto the leg, and they put you back together with one of those.
Yeah.
That's a pretty big price.
That's,
how about your pain threshold, Evel?
I don't know. I think maybe I've become immune to pain. Now, I feel it, and it hurts me. You've been with me many times, not just at the London jump, but you know that I hurt sometimes. I hurt yesterday on the golf course. But I think I've learned to live with it. And I don't have any steel plates in me anymore, with the exception of this one I have here in my arm that I left in maybe for a good luck memento, you might call it. I don't set off any alarm systems in any airports anymore. And I used to have a system that I went by when I was hurt. I'd go to the hospital, and when they were putting one in, I'd have them take one out. So that way, I could save money.
Evel, you've made a lot of jumps. Some of them have been very successful, some not so successful. What's the proper way to do it?
Frank, this jump is the jump that I was a little over the power curve on. You can see the motorcycle is flat going through the air. The front wheel is not up like it should be. When I landed on the rear wheel because I turned on the gas in the air and brought the front end up. In other words, the throttle acts as a means of making the motorcycle become a vehicle that you can will. That throttle on helps that front end stay in the air, like that. That's perfect.
Right,
If the throttle's off, you nosedive. This jump, I had the throttle on way too much, and I landed right on my back. This was taken in Kokona, Wisconsin, and I landed on my back. Motorcycle went out in front of me, and I slid along the pavement and ended up in a sitting up position. I was trying to stand up. I thought it had been a hell of a show if I could have ended up on my feet. But I didn't quite do it. On this jump, I didn't have any choice. When I hit here, I hit so hard that the motorcycle handlebars were just torn completely out of my hands. And this jump was so far that the speed and the impact was just too much to try and control. The water from the fountains on the tires of the motorcycles made it awful slick, and there was just no hope here that anybody could have done anything. I came down from a great height. When I landed, no matter what kind of physical shape I was in at the time, it just ripped everything from me.
It was one of the most spectacular, dramatic shots ever taken, Evel. Where did you realize that you were not going to make that jump? How far into the jump?
I never did, Frank. I thought I was going to make it. This one here, I told the crowd before I ever jumped it that I knew I couldn't make it, but that I had to jump it anyway because I'd made a deal with the promoter. This was in Carson City, Nevada.
How much margin of error is there in speed, Evel? For instance, between 90 miles an hour and 93
miles an hour. About 5 miles an hour, you have to be on the button. This is in San Francisco in the Cow Palace. Motorcycle almost came over backwards on me here, but I got it straightened out. But just as I got it straightened out, I started out of the Cow Palace. And as I went out, the motorcycle flipped me over the handlebars and right into the retaining wall in the outside of the parking lot. And then the motorcycle, of course, got me. This jump was one of the best jumps I ever made. This was probably the most perfect jump that I ever made in my life. This is in Portland, Oregon, in the Coliseum. I jumped 17 vehicles, which is considered the indoor world record. And I landed about 3 feet down the landing ramp, and it was a jump that was just
perfect, wasn't it?
Yep. It was a lucky night.
Let's do it over. Who are you calling? Let's do it over. Come on.
Hello. Western? Let me talk to Rusty. Rusty, this is Evel. We're trying to film over here. Every time one of them airplanes goes out of here, it makes noise and interrupts the film, and I don't want any more airplanes landing here today. All right, if it'll be late, good. I don't want them coming over here for at least a couple hours. I'm only kidding. Goodbye.
You know, I get the feeling, Evel, maybe you weren't kidding. How do you get along with the townspeople? Obviously, the Western Airlines can't be really happy with you.
Oh, they are. They're great. They
How do you get along with the people here, though?
Good.
Is there any resentment of the people you grew up with?
Some there is, but there are so many people that I'm friends with, so many people that I like, so many people that like me, that I don't fool around with those that don't. Who gives a damn? You know, Frank, life is no popularity contest. You know, when God goes to bed every night, he hears a farmer praying for rain, a golfer praying for sunshine. Even God can't please everybody. I don't care what people think. The only guy I need to be right with is me.
Evel, the canyon was the biggest moment in your life. Let's talk about that in just a moment.
Cheeseburger, please.
Oh, you got your braces.
Wonderful.
Children who wear braces have to take special care of their teeth. They need Colgate. Most Colgate kids get fewer cavities. Do you know the average child gets a mouthful of cavities between 5 and 15? Even Colgate can't guarantee just one cavity per checkup, but most Colgate kids don't get so many. One reason, Colgate has MFP fluoride.
Do you know Jerry?
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Colgate. Only your dentist can give teeth a better fluoride treatment.
Hi. Here's the flavor hint I give my students who are on a diet. Cook your onions in a little chicken broth instead of fat. And here's another hint. Real flavor deserves real Baggies. With the alligator, there's no better way to wrap fresh food. Baggies hug food tight, then seal tight, right down next to the food. Baggies is the one I use.
Right! Real flavor deserves real Baggies.
Evel Knievel, Portrait of a Daredevil, will continue in just a moment.
Watch Shark, Terror, Death, Truth, an ABC News special, Sunday at 7:30, 6:30 Central on ABC.
The preparations for Evel Knievel's canyon jump were long, costly, at times comical, and always thoroughly exploited. Ramps were built, tested, and discarded, as was the steam-powered cycle. The first unmanned sky cycle, the X-1, gave the first ominous warning that perhaps Evel was in far over his head. It blasted off the ramp and promptly fell in the Snake River. Still, there was a carnival air to the happenings. The Knievel family, Linda, Kelly, Robbie, and Tracy, all shared in the atmosphere, at least superficially. But as the days ticked closer to September the 8th for Evel Knievel, the fun and gaiety was rapidly disappearing.
The canyon jump was an awful, rough thing for us. I've gone through some things in life because of this motorcycle jumping and canyon jumping that I hope no other man will have to ever go through. Even my critics, I hope they never look into their wives' eyes and see what I saw in my wife's eyes the day before that canyon jump. I hope they never have to sit down and have a talk with their sons and their daughter like I did with mine. And I hope they never have to say a prayer like I said before I punched that fire button and went up into that sky. I wouldn't even wish that on my worst enemy.
He lives from day to day, never thinking about tomorrow. Body shows the scars, fate had dealt his way. Yet Superman, riding on the edge of danger, secure in prayers that God has heard him say. He can move a mountain, leap across the winding river. Once he's made his mind up, there's nothing he won't try.
Stay with the vehicle, put your visor up if you can.
You can't see it now, there she goes.
You need to remember the canyon. is going to crash, obviously, into the river.
It is okay, though. She's coming down about 17 feet per second. Slowly going down.
It has
just cleared the rock.
It looks like he is in the water. Robert Craig Knievel appears to have landed in the Snake River.
It just blew out the back. Nothing happened in the cockpit. The thing just came out the back. That's all. There was no way.
Mechanical malfunction.
Yeah, there was no way that I could have set it off with the dead man switch the way we had it rigged up. It was impossible. When I got back to the launch pad, Bob Truax was very upset. My chief engineer, he said, it wasn't your fault.
You didn't do a damn thing. The can is still on the thing.
It is.
Blew off right here on the launch.
Off by accident?
Yeah, it was our fault. Yeah.
That's not your fault.
Yes, it is. We shut it on one more test.
This is a dead man switch. I had my hand on this, and it was under my leg and pulled all the way back, and I had my knee over my hand. There was no way that that parachute could have got loose. This red button is the fire button. On the countdown, when they said fire, go evil, go, I punched the fire button, held onto this handlebar over here on the left, and took off.
The malfunction of the parachute either saved Evel Knievel's life or cost him a successful jump. In slow motion, it was obvious the chute was deployed even as the X-2 was leaving the ramp. In any event, it brought an abrupt end to any thoughts from a successful jump.
This is the back end of the sky cycle, and this is the canopy that held the parachute. The parachute came off on the launch pad because there was so much total impulse and thrust. It was a mistake that saved my life. If it hadn't come out, I'd have gone in the river and I'd have drowned.
The sky cycle was a primitive piece of rocketry by any measurement. As one reporter noted, it had the glide capability of a piece of lead. Its cockpit was almost glove tight surrounding Evel Knievel. And it had been predetermined by tests that if the sky cycle went into the Snake River, Evel would have had little or no chance to escape. Yet for Evel Knievel, the sky cycle proved to be just another vehicle for success.
Now, let's talk about the business aspect of it. There were millions and millions of dollars discussed. What did you actually realize from risking your life at the canyon?
About $1 million, probably.
Not the 5 or 6 million that was.
No. The thing became too big. We took a state in the United States and tried to promote the world. It was a tremendous promotion, but when you become that big to where you belong to the public, it's like the president walking out and saying, I'm going to have a press conference, but I want to be paid for it. The president can't do that. But you can't take a state like Idaho and jump a canyon as big as the Snake River Canyon and close it off to the world because it becomes a news item. You become a public news item, and there's nothing you can do about it. I wish that we'd have made some more money on it. I wish everybody would have made some more money on it. I wish the city of Twin Falls would have come out better on it, but I really don't care because I'm alive and it's over. And I lucked out. I know there are some people that say, I lucked out. I had 7.5 feet to land in on the ground, or I'd have drowned in the river. It was just a series of 5 mistakes that just saved my life. So I'm glad that it's over. I don't ever want to do it again. I tried it. I missed it. I'm not going to go back and try and make it across. I don't want to. I tried it. I don't care about getting across it. I wish I had it. I'll never try it again. A lot of people have said, that was a publicity stunt, that he's now he'll try again, try and make a lot more money out of it and make it. It just goes to show you how wrong the armchair quarterbacks can be sometimes.
Well, Evel, maybe you only made $1 million at the canyon, but there are other major benefits. Here's Lionel Weintraub, the president of the Ideal Toy Company.
Mr. Weintraub is one of the largest toy companies in the world. What has Evel Knievel meant to your company?
Well, he sparked our sales in a way that very few people have been able to spark sales in the last number of years. And I would say in 3 years, last 2 years plus this year, in this country, Canada, and England, we'll have sold about $75 million worth of Evel toys by the end of this Christmas. And last year, he was about 25% of our sales.
And that 25% of over 125
over $125 million.
He's quite a man, isn't he? Is there any concern on your part, as a question I ask Evel, about a youngster maybe taking the Evel Knievel concept beyond the toy idea and trying it himself and perhaps becoming injured?
Well, of course, our toys are small, miniature toys. They're meant for small children who really can't manipulate anything substantial. And of course, Evel and our advertising always emphasize safety. He's always seen with his helmet on. Evel talks safety. He says, you got to be a pro in order to do the things that he does.
The Evel Knievel toy has skyrocketed. So too has Evel's fame.
I think he's a hell of a man. The man of his word, he did it. I can't believe he did it, but he did it. Took a lot of guts. Took more than enough guts.
Some of the consequences of that fame in just a minute.
This is Leslie choosing a Lifesavers flavor.
I would like some Lifesavers, please.
You want a boost?
That one.
Fancy fruits?
No, the red one.
Cherry Lifesavers?
No, what's that?
Tangerine.
That's my favorite.
No, I'll take it.
Good.
22 delicious flavors are why everyone likes choosing Lifesavers.
Mr. Lifesavers,
a part of living.
I lost my traveler's checks.
Someone stole my First National City traveler's checks.
Now what? It could be this.
I'm sorry, but we must cable the traveler's check company to authorize a refund.
Or this.
Your First National City traveler's check refund on the spot.
What made the difference? First National City Traveler's Checks at 35,000 spots for on-the-spot refunds worldwide. Thousands more than any other traveler's check.
Lasting hold, let you laugh at windy weather. Lasting hold, holds your hairdo together. Lasting hold, looks so pretty and yet holds so strong, holds so long. You can even sleep on your set.
Sleep on your set and wake up with beautiful looking hair. Miss Breck Lasting Hold, the new non-aerosol hairspray, scented or unscented.
You can save money on a new car or truck by buying now at 75 prices. And Chrysler, Plymouth, and Dodge dealers are even cutting those 75 prices by hundreds of dollars off sticker. Now, you can even save on these quality engineered Dodge pickups and vans. Plus, we'll send you a rebate check on almost all car models for as much as $300, $200 on most trucks. So get down to your participating Chrysler, Plymouth, or Dodge dealer and clean up.
Evel Knievel is certainly not the first daredevil. He just happens to be the most celebrated of our time. Others throughout the course of history have also risked their lives for whatever reasons compelled them. Some of these efforts were tragic, but in most cases they were just plain comical. Unlike his predecessors, Evel Knievel's fame and resulting wealth has stimulated others to attempt to duplicate his feats or even surpass them. Many have tried, some have succeeded, and others tragically have failed. This is Debbie Lawler attempting a typical Evel Knievel jump at the Ontario Motor Speedway last year. Debbie had made successful jumps before. This was not to be one of them. Debbie fractured her back in three places. She has since recovered, and it could be said she was fortunate. Certainly more fortunate than Bob Plisseau, who last year, without the benefit of a landing ramp, attempted to jump 30 cars. Bob Plisseau died during surgery 2 hours later. Those are only a couple of the documented attempts to emulate this master, Evel Knievel. What about the others that have not been documented? Evel Knievel is the superhero to many youngsters. And if their master can do it, why can't they? The reasons, unfortunately, have been made painfully clear to some.
You've broken over 50 bones, and there's no way that a youngster who idolized you is not going to want to try to do what his hero does. How do you feel about this, Evel? I know you hear about it, and it's happened many times.
I don't think there's anything wrong with a kid wanting to be an Evel Knievel any more than he'd want to be an O.J. Simpson or a Frank Gifford or be any kind of a professional athlete. I'm saying that he should not go out and jump. I don't want my own son jumping a motorcycle without the proper supervision. I don't want him jumping or riding on the rear wheel without the proper supervision, in the proper place, at the proper time. It's the same as a boy playing football without a helmet on. Shouldn't ride a motorcycle without a helmet on. As far as jumping the cars, I am a professional life risker. There are very few professional life riskers in the world. I'm in a different profession. However, there are a lot of kids that identify with me riding motorcycles, just riding the motorcycles, enjoying riding the motorcycles, thinking maybe about me and not jumping. They all are not necessarily jumpers, but it is a risky business. And I don't advise kids or anybody else to jump cars, jump motorcycles, jump buses, jump canyons. It takes a lot of money, it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of experience, and you have to pay the price for success, and I think you know what price I have paid for that success.
Evel, I know you're well aware of and quite sensitive to the criticism by many that youngsters might imitate you and be injured, some of them very seriously, trying to do what you do. But I know there's some rewarding things that happen, too. For instance, this letter that I found in your file from Jimmy Clark in San Francisco, he was paralyzed from the waist down when he fell out of a tree, and you have sort of become his hero, your ability to continue on, and particularly he mentioned Wembley Stadium.
Here, let me just read a part of it. I saw you jump in London on television. I'm sorry it happened, but you broke your back and walked away from it. I want to tell you to keep on jumping. You keep on jumping, and I'll keep on fighting. Someday I shall stand tall as a king, and I'll walk. That really is touching.
Yeah, he's quite a little guy. I like the last couple of sentences in his letter. It says, if you ever come to San Francisco, you'll always be welcome in my house. We could go for a short walk together. And here's a young boy who wants to fight to try and walk when doctors have told him that he can't. To him, there's no such word as can't. I wrote Jimmy a letter and told him that being not able to walk wasn't really one of the worst things in life. A lot of the leaders of our country are paralyzed from the waist up, not from the waist down. And being a good human being, being something to other people, is what really counts in life. And this boy, you can tell from his letter, like a lot of them that I receive, are kids who maybe have lost the thrill in life of running and jumping and doing what they love to do most, but from the letter you can tell that they haven't lost their heart and their desire to go on and their ability to keep fighting, even when a medical profession says they can't.
Sure, Evel, let's talk about that. I was in London with you, and I had a chance to be in your van just before the jump, and we haven't talked about it, but I sense from your apprehension, your concern about that jump over 13 buses, that you really knew you weren't going to make it. And yet, right there, 20 minutes before you made the jump, you went to sleep.
I don't know. I've kind of trained myself to do that, just to lay down and go to sleep before a jump. It relaxes me. And if you're nervous before you go out, it helps if you can relax and sleep. I knew I wasn't positively going to make it because when I jumped in Toronto over the 13 trucks, those trucks were not as wide as those buses. And when we got the whole jump set up, we found out that it was another 7 feet further. Now, the motorcycles were geared on the rear wheel to run a certain speed. I had the same Harley-Davidson that I had jumped the trucks with in Canada. And it was too late for me to make a phone call to the United States and get the proper gearing over to London for that motorcycle, because they made me set up right after the England-Scotland soccer game. I didn't have a chance. So when I went out of that dressing room, I knew that my chances of landing on top of that last bus flat were better than 50-50. That's really one thing, though, that contributed to my life really not being lost, was because I hung on to those handlebars on that motorcycle all the way to the bottom of that ramp. I knew that I could not let go. And even though it bucked me off and it was flying through the air, I still hung on until I was almost turned completely over, because I knew if I came off up on top, I'd probably break my neck and kill myself. But having the knowledge of that, being able to fall like I can fall, helped save my life.
Then there is no fear.
If there is any fear, I'm not going to tell you about it. You might say I've been concerned a couple times, though.
Deeply concerned.
Yeah.
How about death, Evel? Every time you jump on that thing, you know that you're flirting with it. All of its ramifications. All of this. Linda, the three kids.
Yeah, but Frank, that's all part of living. But death is a part of life. And we're just going to go into another world. And if you're a so-called Christian, which I am, and you're a God-fearing person, you live with that one final hope that you have to cling to, and it helps you get through life. And in my case, it helps me get over buses.
You gotta trust me, Mr. Johnson. This muffler fits 300 different cars.
True, it's smaller than your muffler, but
and an adapter here,
and a thingamabob over here, and a washer.
It's a beauty, huh?
Your car came with a specific muffler to help it run efficiently. That's why we at Midas stock 539 different mufflers. We have the right muffler for your car.
I think I'll go to Midas.
They don't do work like this. Midas.
Have you considered comparing whole wheat total with the leading natural cereals? You'll see there's a big difference. 1 ounce of fortified total gives you 100% of the recommended daily allowance of all these important vitamins and iron. 1 ounce of the leading natural cereals gives you no more than 6%. Check the vitamins and iron listed on the side panels. You'll see 100% versus 6%. That's the total difference.
Welcome to a bright new Thursday on ABC. A cop named Barney and a guy named Fuentes find something funny on both sides of the law. And while Stone and Keller search the streets for wrongdoers, Harry Orwell is still the last resort of the wrongly accused. Barney Miller, On the Rocks, Streets of San Francisco, Harry O, Cops and Robbers, Thursdays on ABC.
When the jump was over in London, I said that I'd never jump again. That was the pain in my body overpowering the brains that I'm supposed to have in my head. I will jump again, but 13 is an unlucky number. This time I'm going to jump 14 buses. I'll do it at Kings Island near Cincinnati, and you can see it live on ABC on October 25th.
When you walk away from the world of Evel Knievel, you leave with perhaps more questions than when you arrived. The overriding question, of course, is why. Why does Evel Knievel continue to risk his obviously beloved possessions, his body and his life, in a continuing escalation of daredeviltry?
One has to wonder, for Evel Knievel, will the canyons ever be wide enough, the jumps long enough, the risk great enough? I doubt it. Evel Knievel has found his place in the sun. He has worldwide fame, he has instant recognition, and he loves it. There are other questions, but there are many and they're complex. What about a society that has created a superhero like Evel Knievel, whose one basic talent he has to offer is risking the ultimate, his life? They've created the superhero for their own entertainment, their amusement, and their own morbid curiosity. What about the youngsters who idolize this man from out of the West? With idolatry goes emulation, and in this case, the possibility of a serious crippling injury or even death. Throughout all this, however, throughout all the questions, one has to admire this man, Evel Knievel, who in a society that seeks for more and more conformity and the elimination of risk, remains a free spirit. Perhaps we all have a little Evel Knievel inside of us, but unlike Robert Craig Knievel, that's where it stays, inside of us.
It seems that everywhere in this world I go, no matter who or what I know, the people, they look. Most of them stare, and I wonder if they really care. You see this cane with its golden crown? Some of them smile, but most of them frown. I hear them laugh, and I see them cry. No matter what, they all ask why. Why? Well, I'm just like you, and you, and you, and your wife. We all have a special purpose in life. And my way of life, I'm glad that I found, for like you, I too make the world go round. We're all alike. Oh, yes, we are. We all have a dream on some faraway star. For me, when it's over and done at the end of a day, my men go to relax, but I go to pray. For I know that tomorrow, in some other place, I'll have that jump again to face. Each time I was hurt, they all said, that guy is lucky that he's not dead. And they were right. But I wanted to get up, to try it again. I kept telling myself that I knew I could win. So I'd close my eyes, and to the Lord I would pray. Oh, help me, God. Let me walk someday. And he did. Every stitch on every scar that just brought me closer to my dream afar. To be a man and to do my best, to stand alone is my only quest. Success is a term that has broad use. For you and I to have none in life, there's no excuse. For you to do what I do is not right. But for me, it's not wrong. What I've been trying to tell you all along is that it's got to be. So, if you wonder why, the answer to that is that just like you, I've got to be me.
Evel Knievel, Portrait of a Daredevil, has been a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television.